We are ready to begin here. Today present, we have all of our council members with the exception of Councilmember Don Gerund and Mayor Tom O'Dell, who are ably representing us in Washington, D.C. at the National League of Cities and meeting with our federal representatives. With that, despite not being on the agenda, why don't we all rise and join me in saying our Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I thought maybe you were providing music.
I should have started earlier.
All right. Public comment. This is an opportunity for the public to address the council. 3-minute limit per person or 5 minutes if representing the official position of a recognized community organization. Do we have a sign up list? Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Laura.
Thank you. We have 7 people signed up today. We'll open up public comment and start with Greg Krabby.
Krabby.
Good evening, Council. My name is Greg Krabby. I'm a civil engineer, and I've been asked by several of the landowners in the no disturbance area to come this evening and comment on the policy, the pilot program that would allow development in the no disturbance area that the Planning Commission has approved and passed on to you folks. Tonight, I would like to direct your attention to the work that has been done to support the Planning Commission's recommendations to approve Evaluation Form 14G, what is known as the Carson Proposal. This evaluation form concerns a proposed pilot program that would allow development within the no disturbance designation of the erosion hazard overlay. I think the first thing that we would like to point out is that this overlay, this no disturbance overlay, was something that was promulgated by King County back in 1994 and then later adopted by the city when it incorporated, and that being as old as it is, it doesn't really take into account modern construction techniques and water quality treatment technologies that are now available. Currently, the water quality of the lake is good, and it has remained good even in the face of urbanization of a significant amount of the basin since this policy was put in place. The Carson proposal makes the following recommendations for allowing up to 3 subdivisions within the no disturbance area as a pilot program to demonstrate that this development can occur without adverse impacts to water quality. The first element is the requirement for tight lining the stormwater discharge directly into the lake. This exemption or this pilot program would apply to those properties that have direct access to the lake. The second element would be to strictly limit construction activities to the drier months. The third element would be the installation of permanent stormwater detention and water quality elements prior to any mass grading of the site. And finally, we recommend or we would require installation of advanced runoff treatment that would remove at least 60% of total phosphorus, not just suspended phosphorus, from the water quality design storm. Now, one of the things I wanted to emphasize is that every one of these elements is supported by best available science. And that science has been submitted or was submitted into the record as part of the Planning Commission process, and all of this information has been reviewed by the Planning Commission as part of their determination. A copy of my letter has been submitted into the record. All of the best available science citations are included on that, and I urge you guys to read it and take a look at the record.
Thank you. Greg. Next on the list, I have Gene Welch.
Hi, I know one of you anyway.
Yeah. Please give your name and address here.
Yes, it's 4228 200 First Avenue Northeast, Sammamish.
Thank you.
Over in Timberline. I want to emphasize to you the sensitivity of Lake Sammamish to runoff. And I've done that with a couple of figures here. If you want to look, do you have this document?
No, we do not have it in front of us.
Okay, all right. Well.
Yeah, we could pass this out.
Okay, all right, and correct it.
Well, let me just, you can, well. The lake has been, it was stated by the previous person here, previous speaker, that the lake has remained stable in phosphorus concentration for the last 20 to 30 years. That's true. It hasn't gone up, it hasn't gone down. There's been some controversy about that. But we can say it's been stable, and this figure number two shows you that conveniently, I think. What I've done is average the five-year periods rather than showing you all these up and down paths of lines representing the changes over time. And if you see, if you look at the blue bar, you see that that's decreased from the time before wastewater was diverted. And you see the past 20 to 30 years, it's remained rather stable at about 18 parts per billion. Now, the value that King County suggested in the late 90s as a maximum for the lake is 22. So it's well below that, and it's stayed stable. And what we predicted in the early 90s with build-out, which is what you need to look at, is the complete build-out of the watershed, not each individual property development, that would have been about 28, almost up to what it was before diversion. So there's potential here through the long term for the increase in phosphorus concentration in the lake. Now, why is the phosphorus concentration remain stable? There's two good reasons. One is that the concentration in the bottom water, the hypolimnion, has gone down. You see, that's the red line here. That's declined over the years. And between 81 and 92, comparing that time period with the last 18 years or so, that quantity has gone down 20%. The reason it's gone down 20% is the phosphorus from the sediments going up into the hypolimnion has decreased. That rate has decreased as a result, the long-term result of diversion of wastewater from the lake. So this volume-weighted average annual concentration has stayed stable because there's less phosphorus coming out of the sediments in the hypolimnion. Okay, that has compensated for any stormwater, that increase in stormwater phosphorus that may have come into the lake. So there's a compensation there. The other factor that's important is this last graph of flow. Issaquah Creek flow has decreased over the years, over the past nearly 50 years. And if you compare the, so as the flow has decreased, the residence time of water in the lake has increased, okay? So the less flow going to the lake, the more time it takes for that water to get out of the lake. So it's a longer residence time. It's just like a waste, like a stormwater pond. You want the water to stay there a long time so the phosphorus will settle.
Mr. Mayor, so you're at 4 minutes
time
now.
Is increased.
Mr. Welch, you need to wrap up. You've exceeded your 3 minutes.
Well, this is it. This is all I'm going to say. That's the other important factor. So the residence time has increased and the phosphorus concentration has gone down. So those are two factors that account for the stability. Without those, the phosphorus concentration may have gone up.
Thank you, Mr. Welch. What is your technical background?
I'm a limnologist.
Limnologist?
Uh-huh.
All right. Thank you very much.
Okay. I was a, well, You don't want to know what I did.
All right, next on the list, I have Jim Osgood. Please state your name and address.
Sure. My name is Jim Osgood, 19661 Southeast 24th Way in Sammamish. My wife Susan is actually passing out my statement for you to follow along if you so wish to. I want to share a few of my thoughts with you related to the opening comments you gave last week about the ECA update process. I was at every Planning Commission meeting that took place over the past year, except for maybe one. I actively participated in many meetings with comments and provided information for the Planning Commission to consider. There's a lot of relevant information to review. That is good. The Planning Commission took over a year in working to fully understand the issues for which they have provided you recommendations. Many of the issues are very technical. That is a concern to me. Your goal is to review their work product and make a decision within a few months. I like that, but because of the volume of information and technicalities, it will necessitate your trusting the work and recommendations of your Planning Commission. Unless, of course, you want to do it all over again for yourselves, which I don't think you do. After all, you did appoint the PC members. You also developed the scope and direction of the review. It is also my understanding that your leadership approved the evaluation form that the Planning Commission used to communicate the rationale of their decisions. What I heard last week from a few of you is that you think the Planning Commission leaned too far to provide flexibilities for property owners. It sounded as though some of you have already taken positions on some of the issues without having studied and understood the best available science and current technology. I do find this troubling. The Planning Commission has gone to great lengths to study and provide you with what you ask for them, a way to provide flexibilities to property owners that will not harm the environment. Environmental protection never took a second seat to property rights in the PC decision-making process. It was always their number one concern. The focus was always on the question, what will this do to the environment? While some of the recommendations went against the consultant's recommendation, the Planning Commission took into account new technologies, which was not a part of the scope of the consultant's report. In addition to best available science, that would still protect the environment in making their recommendations. I am confident in saying that no one in this room wants to cause damage to the environment, but many of us do want fair and just regulations based upon science and technology, not personal prejudices or unfounded fears. All I ask is that you keep an open mind when it comes to evaluating these very complicated issues and the Planning Commission's recommendations. While I do not agree with all of their decisions, they did a very thorough job of evaluating very complicated issues. I urge you to trust the basis of your Planning Commission's recommendations on a whole, making tweaks and fine-tuning as you see necessary. I also want to point out that I have also provided, this is in the City Council comments already, a rationale for support for development in the erosion hazard nuisance water body overlay, which I emailed to all of you, as well as erosion control technology effectiveness review. But do please keep in mind that I am a layman on this, but I have done my best to provide you comments and citations from the Planning Commission.
Thank you, Jim. Next on the list is Ms. Susan Richardson. Please state your name and address for the record.
I'm Susan Richardson. I live at 19661 Southeast 24th Way in Sammamish. I too would like to comment on the perspective from which the council will be discussing and deliberating on the critical carriers ordinance. Last week, the council expressed the importance of protecting the environment. Everyone agrees with that. However, the City Council does not represent the environment alone. You represent the citizens of the interests of Sammamish citizens, including those that assert that environmental regulations infringe unfairly on their property rights. The environment is a subset of your representation. A resource that I would encourage you to read is at least the first 5 pages of the Attorney General's advisory memorandum on avoiding unconstitutional takings of private property. It supports the need of a regulating body to know that there is a limit to the scope of their ability to regulate and the need to avoid over-regulating. Some of the comments include that regulation should be sensitive to the constitutional limits to regulate property rights, that there is a risk of a violation of due process by over-regulating, that to avoid overregulation, there should be a process to evaluate less restrictive means for protecting against the identified harm to be the harm posed by a property. There needs to be a balance of property rights and the government's intended purpose, and that substantive due process requires that legislation must be fair and reasonable in content. We had told the city attorney would provide an opinion on this to the Planning Commission in July. All we got was the Attorney General's memorandum. We suspect that there may have been an opinion given to the city, but that opinion is confidential. However, I would suggest that if you haven't already, council members meet with the city attorney to learn more about the parameters or limits on regulation. Finally, I would ask that we continue through this deliberative process, as we continue through this process, that we avoid labeling ourselves and each other as property rights or environmentalists. As citizens who own property, we all have property rights. Asserting a property right does not make one an enemy of the environment. I would suggest that anyone who faces a loss of a reasonably anticipated financial benefit from their property would be concerned that every effort was made by the city to ensure that the impact was no greater than absolutely necessary. I would hope that that standard of governing would be characteristic of that level of caring for every citizen. Sammamish and Joy is the title of one of the friendliest cities in the U.S. for its size. Let's make sure that fairness is also a part of the city's identity. Trust me, even though there are not hundreds of citizens here now, as each property owner may butt up against what they perceive as an unreasonable regulation, the city's reputation among its citizens will depend on the quality of its decision-making process and the ability to stand behind each regulation as fair and reasonable. Thank you.
Thank you. Just for clarification for the council, Deputy City Manager, was there an opinion given to the city?
Excuse me. The city attorney was consulted early on in the process, and staff did receive a memorandum from the city attorney that was not shared outside because it was subject to attorney-client privilege. The city attorney did recommend, though, the attorney general's opinion as a very useful resource document for the general public and the city as a whole, including the Planning Commission, to refer to. So as Ms. Richardson mentioned, that was what was provided in a public sense. I'll get back in touch with the city attorney, and we are in touch with him now as the council proceeds with its process, and if there's further information, we'll make sure the council gets that.
On behalf of the council, I think we'd be interested to see what was provided. Thank you. Next, we have Mr. Joe Lipinski / Planning Commission member.
I'm here as an individual. And I missed my son's wrestling meet, but he did win by a pin, so. That's how important this is to me.
Please put your name, give us your
name,
address, and your son's name, too.
128 Northeast, first place, Sammamish. He is TJ, and he's undefeated this year. Good evening, council members. I'm here tonight as a citizen and not a planning commissioner. As I see it, in reviewing the ECA on a big level, the council has four broad options. You can, one, make no changes to the old ECA. Two, you can make the ECA even more restrictive. Three, make a few tweaks to the old ECA. And finally, four, make some major changes to the old ECA and make it more lenient. When faced with these broad choices, the Planning Commission spent virtually no time considering options one and two. In my opinion, this is because everyone realizes that the old ECA is unreasonable in the restrictions it applies to property owners. For example, out of over 200 plus cities and towns in the state of Washington that are required to adopt ECA regulations, only the city of Sammamish adopted a regulation that completely prevented building in an erosion hazard area near a sensitive water body. To me, this is completely unreasonable and unfair to the unfortunate citizens who happen to own property in this area. A much more reasonable regulation would entail adopting the regulation that every other city that surrounds Lake Sammamish uses for building in the erosion hazard areas near sensitive water bodies, and that is to simply follow the recently updated King County Stormwater Manual. This solution strikes the right balance of protecting the environment, which we all want to do, and balancing a citizen's rights to use their property. Another example of the old ECA being unreasonable, again, in my opinion, is how it treated small, low-value, isolated wetlands. To remedy this problem, the Planning Commission recommended a tweak or a compromise to the old code. Normally, compromises are good solutions to complicated problems, but not so in this case. And the reason a compromise solution for the low-value isolated wetlands is not a good solution is that the starting point was so unreasonable. Small, low-value, isolated wetlands have very little environmental benefits, but the old ECA regulations caused severe harm to Sammamish residents. For example, the old regulation has prevented Sammamish residents from building their dream home for many years and caused the assessed value of their property lot to drop from over $1 million to $400,000. That is real harm. Once again, a nearby city provides the right balance of protecting the environment and balancing the citizens' rights to use their property. Follow what the city of Renton recently did. Exempt small, low-value, isolated wetlands of up to 4,000 square feet from the ECA. Thank you for your time, and I hope you seriously consider what I'm saying and ask each of these questions to every ECA regulation you adopt. First, does science show that the regulation is necessary? If not, don't adopt it. Does state law require the regulation? Again, if not, don't adopt it. And finally, if it meets those first two questions, is the regulation narrowly tailored to minimize the burden imposed on the landowners affected? I think that's what should be your controlling principle in everything you do. Thank you.
Thank you, and congratulations to DJ again. Next, we have Reed Brockway.
Reed Brockway, 167 East Lake Sammamish Shore Lane, Northeast. From the last study session, it's evident that a fundamental assumption is being made by some of the council members, as has been the case to a degree with staff as well, I might say, that everything that is in our existing ECA code achieves some benefit to the environment, and that relaxing these restrictions in any way is going to be harmful. And it has also been asserted that the changes now proposed are favoring property rights at the expense of the environment. Underlying this is an assumption that the two considerations must be in conflict. Please hear me on this. Our vintage 2005 code was not without significant problems. It was modeled after another jurisdiction's code and was not thoroughly reviewed for its effect on our city and citizens. It was not thoroughly vetted against best available science and contains numerous requirements that are entirely arbitrary. It did not take into account the necessary distinctions between undeveloped land and built-out urban neighborhoods. And it was not devised with adequate consideration as to whether the broad brush restrictions it imposes actually accomplish something in all cases. The result is that it contains significant inequities. It imposes restrictions on our residents that in some cases achieve no environmental benefit. This is a key point. We are preventing some of our citizens that live in the vicinity of an ECA feature from doing things that are entirely within the rights of any other citizens. We are subjecting them to a hassle and expense in order to do such things in other cases. But these restrictions may be achieving no environmental benefit. Of course, that is not true in all cases, but when, for example, you have a low-value feature like an intermittent water course that imposes restrictions on homeowners two or three houses away on either side of it, whose actions would not affect it whatsoever, you have overreaching regulations, and that needs to be fixed. The characterization of this effort to fix the inequities in our code as favoring property rights over the environment is both incorrect and a disservice to those of us who are trying to do something reasonable. Please get into the details and understand what we are saying. Do not operate on the basis of assumptions. Please open your minds to the possibility that we in Citizens for Sammamish are not out to screw the environment. Consider that some of the dogma commonly accepted as best available science, like stipulated buffers and the application of forest practices to urban settings, may be just that, dogma, not best available science that recognizes the difference. And finally, please don't be intimidated by the Department of Ecology, which is steeped in this dogma, but stand up for your citizens and for human concerns as well as for the environment. There's no good reason why the two should be mutually exclusive. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next on the list, we have Ms. Megan Gee.
These are for the council at some point.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mr. David Gee. We're, are we low tech today?
PowerPoint's actually on.
Okay, in here?
Let me log on.
You don't want me touching that. It'll evaporate or something.
Let me try the projector.
Okay, great.
Yes, I'm David Gee, 22201 Northeast 28th Place in Sammamish. And I wanted to actually make a comment that's consistent with some of what's been said about the fact that we need to, as we're talking about these, or as you're reviewing the proposed revisions, would like you to think about where we began. And in the case of the amendment that you're going to consider tonight, you need to remember, or I'd ask that you remember, that we started with an exception for 1,000 square feet of isolated wetland, regardless of the function and value of that wetland. So there was no consideration given, and you'll see in the next slide, that it was simply, if it was 1,000 feet or lower, it was exempt from regulation, or from the requirement that you avoid the wetland in development. The next thing, I guess, as we were talking about the possibilities of revision here, and as we were thinking about ways to follow up on the direction from the plan, or from the City Council, to add flexibility to the code and to address some of the problems that have arisen over the years, one of the simplest things that we came upon was, let's just change a 1 to a 4. How about that? My preference there, and the reason that we chose not to advocate that, was that it seemed like that there were some other jurisdictions, other cities, that were doing it a much more sensible way, that were more focused on function and value, not just absolutes, like, oh, it's 1,000 square feet and therefore it's not valuable, or it's some other number. And so the amendment that is before the council now gives the city and the qualified professional the opportunity, pursuant to the Western Washington wetland rating system, to evaluate the quality, the function, and values of the particular wetland. And in the code amendment that's proposed, there has to be an evaluation that's done that goes through and decides whether this is a wetland that is valuable or whether it's one that is not. And so there's no speculation or no need for speculation as to whether we're hurting the environment or not hurting the environment. And in fact, as you think about the fact that we've gone from 1,000 square feet of no analysis of the value and function, and we're talking about expanding, but we're also saying only in those cases when we know that it has zero or very little function and value. So we did that, and I can't make this turn, but if you look further, did you guys get these handouts? You ask? I can't make this turn.
I don't see the handout.
Oh, here we go. Anyway, this is consistent with some of the advice given by DOE, and then also consistent with what many other jurisdictions in Western Washington have done. And all of these ordinances that are cited there function as does the proposed amendment on the function and value of the isolated wetland. And so then you've also got a copy of the Renton one, which has gone through not just the ECA review, but more recently the Shoreline Master Program, and it's been approved by DOE as recently as just over a year ago. Thanks.
Thank you, David. That's all I have on the official sign-up list. Is there anybody else who would like to add public comment? If so, please line up, state your name and address for the record.
Good evening. I'm Larry Martin, 777 108th Avenue Northeast, Bellevue, Washington, reside in Redmond. I represent the estate of Lenore Probst. Our concern is the erosion overlay part of the critical areas ordinance. We support the tight line storm drainage aspect of the Planning Commission proposal. We believe the tight line proposal should be supported because it eliminates stormwater erosion from property development. This is the impact that the critical areas ordinance is intended to address. Let me give you some real quick background. In 1980, Mr. and Mrs. Probst purchased about 17 acres of land in what was then unincorporated King County. They built their home on the property. They lived there until Bob passed away, and actually Leonore continued to live there in their home until she passed away in 2011. The Probst land is located along Northeast 49th Plates. It's just south of the border between Sammamish and Redmond. The neighboring land on the north and on the east has been developed into residential neighborhoods. Mrs. Probst's family members need to sell the property. The market demand for the property is to develop into a residential neighborhood. They can't do this under the current code because the erosion area overlay portion of the critical areas ordinance prohibits them from dividing the land into residential lots. The prohibition on subdivision is the method the code uses to eliminate the potential of erosion that can be caused by improperly controlled stormwater runoff from developed areas. It's simple. The code reasons no development, no stormwater. It's a very broad solution, obviously, to the problem. This erosion overlay portion of the CAO doesn't regulate steep slopes. We're not proposing that we should be able to develop steep slopes. It deals with just moderate sloped areas, but it's those moderate sloped areas where the soil types are classified as being subject to erosion. The environmental impact that the ordinance is focused on is caused when stormwater that hasn't been adequately controlled is allowed to flow into gullies and streams. When it flows into gullies and streams at too high a rate, this can cause erosion. The erosion transports with sediment phosphorus, which makes its way to the lake, contributes to algae growth and degradation of the water quality. We have been teaming with our potential subdivision developer and Mr. Krabi and his engineering firm, who are experts in stormwater management. And as a team, we presented to the Planning Commission a proposal that would avoid the risk of erosion by requiring that all stormwater be routed through a sealed pipe. This is the so-called tight line feature of the code amendments. If I could, I'll just wrap up real quickly.
Thank you.
Our main point here is that this is using the first rule of mitigating environmental impacts, which is to avoid the impact before you then go down the line and try to adopt mitigation to impact. This would avoid the impact. The proposal would require that before any of the subdivision is built, you have to first build a permanent drainage system that will capture all the drainage, run it all the way down to the lake. It avoids the harm that the ordinance is addressed at, which is stormwater runoff into gullies and streams, which causes the erosion.
Thank
so
you.
We believe it merits your support. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Mark Cross, welcome back.
Thank you for having me. My name is Mark Cross. I live at 247 208th Avenue Northeast in Sammamish. I know we have a lot of information that's being provided to you. One of the things that the Planning Commission in the task that you directed them to wasn't really asked to do, nor was staff, was to really go back and look at the 2005 code that the city created and to determine really, how has it done? So we don't really have a lot of information on how the code that was adopted in 2005 has done. We did, though, as a previous council, without a couple of the current members, look at whether or not we should require a low-impact development on properties when people develop single-family houses across the city. And it was decided that, no, we wouldn't do that, not like Bellevue, not like some of these other cities that you've heard about, but that we would just do that with the larger developments. So that means there is more storm runoff. There's more storm runoff when you fill wetlands of any size, whether they have lots of biological function or not, you lose the storm drainage detention. You're simply pushing more water onto the next property owner. You're not getting some of the phosphorus retention that is needed. As to the rights of individuals in the city of Bellevue, if you develop on a piece of property above 40%, you're limited to about a 3,600-foot footprint, like you had a property that was all wetland. You still get to build a house, but you have to do a reasonable use with a limited development of the property. The very same city of Renton that gets cited for having a 4,000-foot exemption also starts to control steep slopes at 25%. And then at 40% puts very severe restrictions like the city of Sammamish does. So what I want you to do is to understand that as people cite various cities to you, is understand that many of those very same cities have very tough codes in other restrictions that they have in place, and that simply stringing together the most generous pieces of code that you can find is not necessarily always going to give you the ideal code across the city. We do need to have people who are private property owners control their own storm drainage to the best extent of that it can be done. And yet we have streams that run thick with both human waste and animal waste. Those are private property owners who are actually taking action so that the downhill stream property owner can't or shouldn't touch that very same stream after it passes through these other properties. Where's the balance here in pursuing happiness? I know people are interested in their own property rights, but they also have to understand that their property rights are balanced with everybody else's. And as we learn how to create a city at the kind of densities that we're talking about, it's more and more important that each property owner take responsibility for their own impacts, and that's what we're asking for, and not simply to look for the most lenient codes that can be found, because many of those cities also have very tough components to their codes so that they can be flexible in other locations. And I think you have some tough codes, but that's not necessarily a reason to simply relax them all. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who wants to speak to the council? Seeing none, I close public hearing for today. Oh, public comment. The gavel. With that, I will open up our study session. And Deputy City Manager, I understand we have two topics today: the pavement management program overlay, followed by our environmental critical areas update.
That's correct, Mr. Deputy Mayor. Laura Philpott and Jim Gruber with our Public Works Department will present to you the pavement management overlay program. And we'll try to keep that to about 30 minutes, so I'll keep an eye on the clock for you.
Well, good evening, council members. I'm glad to be here. I will try to be quick. I know you guys have a lot of interesting things to talk about tonight. So this is the 2013 pavement preservation program. A few topics that we want to talk about briefly are a summary of our road network and the history of the local streets, the review of the program policies that we have in place for pavement management, recommendations for our 2013 street resurfacing projects, and recommendations for a potential four-year plan. So this map shows a summary of our whole city network for the roadways. We're at about 20% of arterial roads, 80% of local roads. It's a total of 76 lane miles for the arterials and 284 lane miles for the local streets. These next few slides is just a quick summary of the history for locations.
Can you point out very quickly on the map which ones are the arterials? I mean, I know 228th and Lake Sam, but.
Yeah, sorry. So everything in green is our arterial roadways. Everything in the magenta color is our locals. So 228, starting up here is the Hollyway, and then 228 running through Issaquah Pine Lake Road. This is Southeast 32nd, Issaquah Beaver Lake Road and Southeast 32nd together. Duthie Hill Road, Trossachs Boulevard. Over on the left, there's 212. This is Lewis Thompson up here, and then 212th, and then 212th Way, going back down to the Parkway, and then Parkway, East Lake Sammamish Parkway, all the way up along the lake.
Thank you.
So before 1970, there were approximately 9 miles of local streets that were built within the boundary of the city. In the 70s, there were almost 17 miles that were added to it, most of those being up in the north half of town. In the 80s, there was a large increase in the amount of local streets, again, the bulk of it being up in the north half. 36 miles, almost doubled what was here previously. In the 90s, we saw more growth happening in the southeastern side of town. A lot of that is the Trossachs development. And another 35 miles were added. Then in the 20s, things slowed down, or in 2000 and after that, things slowed down a little bit. There were about 20 miles added. So this map shows us how many miles of roadway within the city have been surfaced since we've incorporated. There are 94 lane miles that we've covered. 46 of them are arterial miles, 48 are local lane miles, which is about a 50-50 split. The bulk of these miles have been done through the surface, through the overlay projects. A small percentage of them, well, 77 lane miles have been paved through our surfacing projects. The rest of them have been done through capital improvement projects. So this chart here shows us how we've been moving forward with our street surfacing projects. Earlier on, we were averaging about 3 miles of lane miles per year. And as we got later in 2009 through 2012, we were starting to see that the amount of money we had budgeted wasn't enough to handle our arterial roads, to make improvements on our arterial roads. So budget was increased, and we started to put a greater emphasis on improving our arterial streets. So with those improvements, we've been able to bring up our conditions on our arterial streets to what we call is a good condition, a pavement condition rating of 75. Our local streets are at a little bit below where we want to maintain them. They're just in the upper 60s. Overall, our network is right at good condition, which is about where we set as a goal to maintain them. So into the program policies, our three things that really affect the street surfacing is the pavement condition index, the budget, and the budget distribution. So our pavement condition index is the system that we have in place to rate the street conditions, how well they're performing, and track and monitor the pavement conditions. So once that got started, we established that our goal was to maintain our pavement condition above a 70. That was a number that was set in place, sort of as a policy that council had determined was a good balance between the amount of money it would take to improve streets higher than that, to bring it into a better condition than that, versus letting them continue to crack up. So the budget distribution, in the past couple of years, the council has made some good decisions to increase our payment budget to maintain that rating of 70. We're currently spending about $3 million per year towards the surface, towards street maintenance. And then our budget distribution, it's showing that earlier on, we were spending about 40% of our budget on arterials, 60% on locals, and we've since started to balance that towards 50% arterials and almost 50% locals. So it shows that we're still spending a little bit more on locals than we are on arterials, but that we, one of the things to point out is that over 80% of our network is local streets. So we have about seven items or criteria that we use to put together our pavement programs. Pavement condition is the main criteria that's tied to that pavement condition rating that we use. Service volume, age of streets, proximity, those are three criteria that have a greater focus towards the streets that we select. Surface volume is tied heavily towards the arterial roadways. Age of streets is tied to all of the roadways. We look at streets that are older than 10 years typically for the arterial roads, and streets that are older than 20 years right now for the local roads. Proximity is something that is a heavier weight for local streets. It's something that we use. We try to bunch streets together, look at areas that we can get a lot of street surfaces covered. It helps us with keeping costs down. It helps us with just managing the projects. Then the other three, maintenance, utility coordination, and street type, those are just some criteria that they can go either way with some of the streets that we're looking at. So this map highlights all of the streets that would fall under our criteria for an overlay. There are the green streets. There's 83 miles of roadway highlighted on there. Approximately 13 of those miles are arterial streets. The rest of them are local streets. So with those criteria that we use and the age of the streets, the condition of our arterial roads, this map here highlights what we're looking at recommending for our 2013 street resurfacing. There's four lane miles of arterial streets, classified streets on here, and about 17 lane miles of local neighborhoods. So the classified streets are Inglewood Hill Road. That is a project that we have grant money, federal grant money tied to for maintaining that. Lewis Thompson Road, that is a street that we had looked at in the past, but we had left off because of a utility project that Sammamish Plateau Water and Sewer District had or was proposing to work on in the future, and it would have impacted, sort of would have been throwing away dollars to go and pave it and then have it come back, utilities come back in 5 years and tear it all up again. So we pulled that off. Their project has fallen through for budget reasons, and so we're putting that back on our recommendation list. The other street is 244th. That's a section of roadway, arterial roadway, that is tied to our sidewalk, our non-motorized project that we are working on this year to build sidewalk and widen shoulders for bike lanes. And then the local streets, there's the Timberline neighborhood. This is one of our older neighborhoods in the city, and there are Hampton Woods, The Country, Evans Creek. Those are more of our older streets. On the east side of 228, there's Pacific Estates and Northeast 25th Way. And down on the south here, this is one of the neighborhoods that we had in our proposal last year. And it was in our bids as an additive, but we had decided to pull that out because of unknowns for the Southeast 8th Street Park. We weren't sure how much of the roads would be impacted by that. Parks has had a chance to look into it more and feel that this would be appropriate to include. So our 2013 budget, this is a breakdown of our dollars. We have $2.5 million of the $3 million budget allocated towards street overlays this year. Actually, 2.7 with including 244th. We have another $150,000 allocated towards patching. This is a lot of localized patching where we have, for instance, streets where we have springs seeping up through the pavement. We want to get in there, do some under drains, repair those localized areas so that they're prepped and ready to go for future street resurfacing. And then $100,000 being put towards crack sealing. And then the remaining $50,000 is separated for the material testing and inspection that we need to have done with the overlays. So this is a potential four-year resurfacing plan. It is, I'd like to make it very fuzzy because it's not set. It shows that we're doing about 20 lane miles per year and that the bulk of it is still towards local streets. The distribution works out to be about 25% of arterial roads, 75% of local roads. The streets that are shown on that map for arterial streets, it's Issaquah Beaver Lake Road, Duthie Hill Road, East Lake Sammamish Parkway, and a portion of 228th Ave. So this is just a list of remaining arterial streets that after those 4 years, if those arterials were to stay on, a plan would not have been overlaid. Two of the streets on here to point out, I guess, are 212th Way. That's a street that we are just continuing to patch to try and resurface. That would be a lot of pavement repair, and there's other issues along that. That's the one that leads down from the long stretch of 212 down to the parkway. And then Southeast 4th Street.
Snake Hill?
Yeah, 212th Way with Snake Hill, yeah.
Thank you.
And then Southeast 4th Street is the stretch of road between 228th and 214th that falls within the boundaries of the town center. It isn't in very good condition right now, but we had made the decision in the past that since it's likely to be updated, that it would be best just to maintain it as is and continue to patch it rather than spend the money to overlay it. So what's next is our overlay. If we move forward with the overlay schedule, we would look at advertising in April, awarding our contract in May, and beginning construction on the street resurfacing in June, hopefully be completed in November. Do you have anything to add to that? And that's pretty much it. If you guys have questions or comments.
Questions from the council? Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you.
Yes. Councilman Wynn.
I guess I support the four-year project. I wouldn't get a cost or even any rough information on what future years would cost.
Oh, sorry.
But I certainly support the 2013 work program proposed.
The four-year, Laura Philpott, Public Works Director, the four-year proposed plan is assuming the same funding levels that the council has provided in the 13-14 budget. As we develop the 15-16 budget, we will come forward and look at that in more detail. But at this time, we're just trying to project and be planning ahead. So,
okay. Do you want a head nods on this then?
I guess the biggest question for us, if there's any concerns with the streets that staff has recommended for this year, we would like to hear them now before we finalize bid documents and put them out for construction.
Well, before that, let me take some questions because we do have some more questions. Councilmember Vance.
Pardon me. In the past, if we've come up with other funds, somewhere, somehow, we've added on to that list, I believe.
What we've done in the past is when we go out for advertising, we do include some optional neighborhoods. We, as Jim showed, we have $2.5 million kind of rough budgeted for the overlay program, but we'll go out to add with what we think is $2.5 million and we'll add additional streets. So if the bids come in lower than what we anticipate, we will bring those streets and the council would help us make the decision at that time of which additives.
So like last year, you could move some of those into 2013 and off the list for 2014?
Correct.
Okay.
Any other questions? Any concerns to share with Public Works? So, if not, then I will ask for a head nod consensus of moving forward.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Mayor. Glad to see progress on that, and we're working ahead of schedule, so that's a good thing.
2 minutes.
Next item on the study session is the environmentally critical areas update. This is second or third meeting in a series of meetings. The council is having study sessions mostly to go through the material as presented by the Planning Commission. You had a meeting on this subject last week on a couple of the major items. We've teed up a couple more here for tonight. And as you recall from laying out the schedule, we've identified two or three major subjects to handle at the study sessions that are happening in March and April, culminating in an opportunity on April 15th to handle any additional items that come up. This is all leading towards public hearings and deliberations for the council in the May, June, July period. I'd like to ask Evan Maxim, our senior planner, to go through a series of slides for you here tonight. As you have done in previous sessions, staff are happy to answer questions along the way. So this is a good opportunity to drill down and make sure that you fully understand what's been done by the Planning Commission, the rationale behind their recommendations, and how they would apply. And then as what happened last time, if there are ideas for potential amendments that come up along the way, you can certainly ask staff to follow up in that regard. And then we'll be compiling all of the council member comments and amendments for your public hearing sessions later in May and June.
Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor, City Council. I'm Evan Maxim, one of the senior planners for the City of Sammamish. Just going to go over the schedule very briefly. I did modify it slightly, subject to the council's approval, adding a meeting in May. We'll touch on the two major issues that we already had slated for tonight, and then follow up. We had a question, I believe, at our last study session about which minor items could we reasonably consider as substantive. The schedule here is largely what you saw at your last study session last week. What I've added on is the April 15th, the last bullet there. The minor items with the substantive content where you want to explore those further. And then, as Cameron mentioned, the follow-up of any or related to any questions that we might get during this process, this initial review that we haven't touched on up until that date. And that leads me actually into the first major item from there. The first item that we have on the agenda is the Wetland Mosaic Amendment. This has been identified as item 3-7B. This item essentially is a clarification of how wetlands are regulated by the state in general. And I've included in here a graphic which is, I apologize, it's a little bit of a funny color here, but not quite the highest resolution, I guess is what I'm trying to say. This would represent a wetland mosaic that would be regulated essentially as one feature under the state guidance today. The bottom version of that same graphic would be a set of wetlands that would not be regulated as an isolated wetland. And there are some very specific criteria in the state guidance documents about how close those wetlands are when they're being evaluated as to whether or not they are a wetland mosaic or not. This is something that Ecology and actually our consultant brought up when we were discussing the isolated wetland exemptions. That's our next topic after this item. This is a clarification in our code of the state regulation. So this does not add a substantive additional constraint onto a property owner in of itself. What this does is it provides an explicit direction in our code that when we are evaluating isolated wetlands, in particular for the exemption subject we're going to get to in a moment, we have to take into account whether or not those wetlands that are being evaluated are part of the mosaic. Again, this would be required anyways by the Washington Department of Ecology, but it makes it an explicit statement, so we're very upfront about it in our code. And with that, I'm happy to go over to the evaluation form and answer any questions by the City Council.
He's going to go over.
Oh, that's what I was going to ask.
Yes.
Sorry.
So I have the evaluation form up here. I'll just go over it very briefly. This is something that we think is a positive in the environmental effect because it frankly it decreases the likelihood that we would somehow underrepresent the wetland when we're initially applying the wetland exemption regulations to a wetland that might be part of a mosaic. We're being upfront about it, again, explicit for both the consultant and the city's application. Because we are improving our clarity in our code, we think this is an implementation positive. It will be consistent with the state agency guidance, so we expect the state to support it, and in fact, they have given us comments to that effect. And then from a property owner standpoint, again, because this is not an actual substantive change to the property owner regulation, this is just a clarification, we think it has a neutral effect to the property owner, which leads us to our overall effect of positive. If I may, Council, I'll offer one other comment. The major items that we're going to go through, some of these items, I think were initially identified by the Planning Commission as possibly having the need for more analysis than perhaps they warranted when the Planning Commission fully understood the item and started its deliberation. I think it would be fair to characterize this particular amendment as one of those. It sounded very compelling when we first identified it as part of our best available science review. When they really got into the meat of the amendment, it was less of a concern on the part of the Planning Commission.
Question from the council?
Just note that the Planning Commission's vote on this was 6-0. I think we had an absent member that night, but
I understand. That said, I have a comment on it, and reiterating my comment earlier on and in the session with Councilmember Gerund, with the Deputy City Manager, as I started to look back and into public comment, I believe it's 220. Let me see if I can find that here. There's a note from the Department of Ecology who says that they don't believe that this should be done. In the note that I have here, it says a, hold on a second. If I can find that again. Oh, here it is. And I believe this is public comment 220, if I'm not mistaken, that was taken. And it states, because the city is not proposing to change the way it rates wetlands within its jurisdiction, the Washington State Wetland Rating System for Western Washington already provides a method for determining whether a wetland area is part of a mosaic or is to be rated separately. Ecology does not believe that it is necessary to provide additional code language on how to determine whether a wetland is part of a wetland mosaic. And it goes ahead saying we're already covered, that the section's already covered and addresses the concept by the state law. Given that, as you had mentioned, Evan, that it's less compelling, we are obviously here only seeking consensus. There's no deliberation taking place, and we'll come back with more information, but at this point in time, I don't see a need for this to go forward unless you present something additional.
No, I think the amendment was purely a clarification suggestion by our consultant. I don't think there's a necessary change here.
All right. Any other comments? Councilmember Whitten.
You mentioned clarification. A lot of our whole thrust here was to clarify. Is that?
I think that's certainly part of the known topic scope and part of the Planning Commission's recommendation.
Yeah. I mean, when you have an applicant come in with a wetland and nobody's read in the code the word mosaic and suddenly it's thrown at them in an application process.
Right.
Have you had that happen? I'm just...
Yeah, and I'd offer the thought that I think the staff felt this was a valuable amendment in that clarification context. We often get property owners who will review the city's code and attempt to, for lack of a better term, self-diagnose the applicable regulation to the site. Where the wetland mosaic has not been previously mentioned, this is something that would call it to their attention, and hopefully they would investigate further or frankly call the city staff so we can help guide them through the process. Having said that, I would agree with Deputy Mayor's Valderrama's comments that it's not a necessary change. This is purely a clarification change.
But it's a helpful change to citizenry. Is that what I'm hearing?
I believe it could be, yes.
Thank you.
Any other comments? Questions? Thank you very much.
This leads us into the second kind of major topic that we have tonight, and probably the more substantive discussion. And this is related to actually something you've had some testimony on both tonight and at our first meeting. This is related to the wetland development flexibilities that we offer around our isolated wetlands and our low-value non-isolated wetlands. And there's two components to this particular amendment. Of course, I'm referring to item 3-19E. Remind the City Council, of course, this is in Volume 1 under Tab Number 2, the Planning Commission's evaluation forms. And I'll pause for a moment. Councilmember Witten had asked for a roadmap document that would identify all of the various links between the volumes and the proposed amendments. I did hand out a copy of that. This is our first cut at the roadmap document. I put a copy on your podium earlier tonight. I also provided some copies here on the table behind me for the public. This is our first draft. I have not completed the full roadmap for all of the amendments, but it's a good reference at least for the first four that you've considered. So the fee and lieu discussion we had at our last meeting, and then the two items tonight. We will update your volume so you have it in the volume. I just wanted to give you a little bit of a preview for tonight, and of course, whatever added value might have.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So getting back to the topic at hand, of course, this is in Volume 1. The evaluation form is in Tab Number 2, the Planning Commission's adopted evaluation form. Do you want to make it clear to the City Council, this is one of the items that's explicitly not supported by best available science. The Planning Commission has recognized that they're recommending this particular amendment to serve another goal, which is to provide additional flexibility to property owners when they're engaging in development of their property. Remind the City Council, we have a specific document in your Volume 1 identifying areas where the Planning Commission's recommendation has deviated from best available science. This is one of those items. It's called out on that roadmap I referred to a moment ago. This amendment does two things at a basic level. First, for small, non-isolated, low-value wetlands, we have an option that we've provided to reduce the buffer that would typically be 50 feet down to 15 feet. So your buffer is more than going in half.
Can I ask, is that already existing?
No, this would be a new amendment. The two I'm going to describe right now are new amendments. And I actually have a graphic on the next slide which will illustrate this.
But we don't have an evaluation form for the buffer reduction.
These are both part of item 3-19E.
Thank you.
Both of these amendments.
Could I, just before we go on, is there a standard definition of low-value wetlands?
There is. In the code, we're actually using the habitat score, and I believe it's a habitat score of 15 or less. This is one of the items that the GUI presentation earlier tonight noted as an added value to this particular amendment. They referenced the riparian definition, the habitat score rating, which is not in our current code today. They were absolutely correct about that. But low value in general tends to mean habitat score in this context.
I wonder, because in the areas where it is not supported by the basic science or the best available science. I'm reading here that for these types of wetlands should be reviewed on the basis of of a watershed-based context as opposed to habitat or something else. Is that really the area?
Can you tell us where you're
I'm reading on page 10 of the basic best available science in the watershed.
This is the AMAC report?
I believe so.
Wetlands?
Okay. Wetlands.
I can
give you the whole just there's a table there that compares some of the various exemptions by jurisdiction and a brief description of the compensation required. It says, it is suggested that any application to fit small isolated wetlands be reviewed in regards to the wetlands function in a watershed-based context. In other words, does it infiltrate? Does it, I would assume, does it, if you changed it, would it cause issues elsewhere? So we're looking at it from that point of view as well. So
that would certainly be part of the best available science documentation.
I guess what I'm asking is this where we're differing from from them? Is this the departure point? We're not looking at it as a watershed?
It would be one of the departure points, and maybe I should clarify for the That'd council's reference where we've departed.
I would ask that the council hold their questions so that Evan can finish his presentation. I think some parts of this may be answered in his presentation, and then we can open it up. Thank you.
Okay. If you'll bear with me for 2 seconds, I think we'll get back to that point, okay. Councilmember Vance. The other aspect to this particular amendment is we have provided an increase in our ability to alter small isolated wetlands. I want to emphasize the word isolated here. The amount of alteration could be up to 2,500 square feet, and this would be for wetlands with a total area of up to 4,000 square feet. This gets a little bit complicated, so if you'll bear with me, I'm going to run through just a couple graphic slides. What you have on the screen before you, of course, is the typical property we have in the city of Sammamish. We have a small wetland, less than 4,000 square feet. I always get that less sign wrong. I apologize for that.
You should say less than, not greater than.
Yes, I have two greater than symbols, and I apologize. It should be less than symbols. I'm not very good at math, clearly. Low-value wetland habitat, the habitat score here is referenced. You have the wetland boundary. You have the wetland, and this would represent the 50-foot buffer that would be standard off a low-value wetland of this type. The first flexibility the Planning Commission has recommended is to provide for a reduced 15-foot buffer that would represent this interior line here. We're talking about buffers now, and I'll remind the City Council, you have off of a wetland, in every case, a buffer, and then you have a 15-foot setback on top of that. The difference between a buffer is a buffer remains more or less in a natural condition. The setback is an area that could be landscaped, you could have a driveway, you could have other site improvements, you just can't have a building, frankly, you can't have a house. So the actual location of the house would shift from 65 feet away from this wetland, 50 feet plus 15, to 30 feet from this wetland, 15-foot buffer, 15-foot setback. That's the first flexibility offered under this amendment.
And so again, I have to stop you there. That is currently not allowed at all in our current code.
Right.
That reduction in buffer size.
That is correct. Not under the tool that we're talking about right now, at least. We do have other buffer reduction methods.
Not in the same way for these types of wetlands.
Right. The other version of the flexibility, and again, I have the greater than sign, not the less than sign, which is truly embarrassing, but we have a small wetland area. We have an isolated wetland. I do want to emphasize this. This means hydrologically isolated, so you don't have a surface water connection, and you don't have a groundwater connection. And these are two components that have to go into the review before this tool would be applicable to a property owner or available for a property owner. And again, the low-value wetland, this would be the 15 habitat score. Again, I didn't put it up on this screen. What we have now is then, of course, the option to fill up to 2,500 square feet of the wetland. That fill would be mitigated, either on-site or off-site. In a case like this, you might see the mitigation on-site. You would have the new buffer applying off the new wetland area. So it's essentially a reconfiguration of the wetland. The other option that might be out there is, as you may recall from our discussions, if it's not possible to mitigate on-site, we might be looking at in the same sub-basin or, frankly, a fee-in-lieu program if that's authorized by the City Council. Getting back to your question from a moment ago, Councilmember Vance, where this departs from best available science, I think it's fair to say that there's maybe two or three areas that we could clearly call out for the record as far as where best available science draws the line. We've heard repeatedly from the Department of Ecology and from our consultant that best available science does not identify a lower end for where wetlands should be protected. So best available science in general would argue that we should protect wetlands down to the 1 foot square wetland at the extreme end. Department of Ecology has also commented into the record that they recognize that that's not a practical alternative for most jurisdictions. And so they have tended to draw the line at 1,000 square feet on up to, in some cases, as you've heard testimony tonight, in the Shoreline Master Program, they have approved a 4,000 square foot isolated wetland exemption. In the conversations that the city has had with the Department of Ecology, they've also cautioned us not to simply benchmark this specific flexibility tool against other jurisdictions without looking at their critical area codes as a whole. So as I believe Mark Cross testified earlier, Department of Ecology is essentially ask that we look not only at the wetland, isolated wetland exemptions here, but that we also look at other functions of the critical areas code when determining how we match up with other cities in terms of providing a parity. So that's, I think, a short summary of where we're getting away from best of all science. Again, this is something that the Planning Commission recommended for development flexibility.
Deputy City Manager.
Thank you. Just to clarify, Evan, thank you for the description there. Our current code does allow a tool that's like this, though, today.
And yes.
This was adopted, I think, either when we incorporated it as part of King County Code,
right.
It was reviewed when we did our first critical areas update in 2005. And maybe just repeat for the council what our current code provides for and kind of draw the distinctions between our current code and this tool.
So what our current code, of course, allows for right now is up to 1,000 square foot wetland of any habitat score to be completely filled, and you have to mitigate the functions and values of that wetland somewhere within the city. Mitigating the functions and values is not the same thing as what we're talking about for mitigation under this proposed amendment. Mitigating functions and values, you typically have two flavors of that. One is related to water quality, water retention, hydrology, things of that nature, and the other is the habitat values. The water quality, water hydrology component usually is addressed as part of a development in their stormwater system. The habitat values, by and large, are addressed as part of wetland enhancement, not actual wetland creation. This item 3-19E, of course, is focusing on true mitigation, as you might have heard me describe at our last meeting. You have wetland creation as a component of the mitigation for this option, and then you have additional enhancement or mitigation as necessary from there. There's one other nuance I want to make sure is clear for the City Council, which is when we're talking about the isolated wetland exemption, we should be clear what the exemption is to. The exemption is to the avoidance sequencing requirements. It's not an exemption from any other aspect of the code other than the requirement that you first avoid impacting the wetland, then minimize, and then mitigate. What this lets you do is kind of bypass all of that and focus on the mitigation component.
So part of the reason, Mr. Deputy Mayor, why I asked the question is to note that we have a tool in code today. We've been administering that code, and it's not a frequent thing, but it does come up a handful of times each year where we employ that tool, along with other kinds of flexibility tools like buffer averaging and things like that in our current code. This would, I think, take our code in two directions simultaneously. One, the amount of impacted area grows. So the impact associated with this, you could say, is larger. You're going from 1,000 up to 2,500 square feet. On the other hand, you're restricting the candidate types of wetlands by imposing a habitat score and other criteria. So it's not any type of wetland, but only the lowest functioning wetlands that are candidates. And you're requiring this mitigation requirement for actual replacement of wetland of the impacted area. So if they choose 2,500 square feet or some lesser number, they have to actually replace that amount. And ideally, the first choice is to try to replace it on site, as shown in the example here. There are a lot of passionate voices around this, as with several other of the amendments that are before you. I think what the Planning Commission did, and I go back to these evaluation forms as a way that helped them do that, is understanding that there was a higher level of impact because you're moving from 1,000 to 2,500. What could they do to mitigate for that and make this lesser of an environmental problem by, again, limiting the type of wetlands and increasing the mitigation requirements? So they've tried to give you a little bit more of a complete package in this. Maybe one other quick comment about the Department of Ecology. As we've talked about in this process, state agencies are commonly commenters and offerers of advice and guidance in processes like this. Council needs to make the choice on this, but if you choose to also, in addition to amending your ECA code, to also apply that amended code in the shoreline area, we'll have to pursue an amendment to the Shoreline Master Program. Mm-hmm. And that's where ecology moves from a commenter to an approval. And that was one of the reasons why we were compelled to meet with Ecology while the Planning Commission was going through their process to try to understand what things they would be concerned about. Assuming that the council may want to entertain a shoreline master program amendment, again, you haven't made that decision, but if you choose to do that, we're going to give you the tools necessary to make that case to Ecology. And this also, as Evan said, represents how we fit within comparable jurisdictions. Deputy Mayor asked for more information in that regard, and we're going to be assembling that for the council and providing that to you in the coming days.
Thank you, and I look forward to that clarification information that's going forward. Again, a reminder to the council that we will be doing the deliberations in May, that here we're going to be asking clarification questions, seeing if there's any modifications or suggestions, and seeking consensus, if possible. With that, let me open it up to questions from the council. Which one? Councilmember Crowley.
So you stated we parted company from Best Available Science. Did we do that early on, way before the dance started, when we assumed that we were going to try to do something to affect the size or at least determine the quality of a wetland? Early on, Best Available Science says all wetland, as you described it, right?
Right.
1 square foot by one. So at that point, they were out, right?
It's perhaps a matter of degree is the only point I would make. We may be on the same dance floor, but not dancing together at this point. I think we've moved away from Best Available Science in the sense that...
Well, we parted company with them when we engaged in the discussion of quality of wetland, right? Right. And size of wetland.
When we considered an impact to a wetland, we parted company.
We left them early.
That's right. And that's, okay. Of course, in our current code. We've already have... Our current code allows that type of impact. The City Council's known topics list asked us to take another look at that,
okay,
and see whether there were additional flexibilities that we could offer local property owners. And this quickly came up as an example,
mm-hmm,
that we wanted to consider. So we rapidly looked at what not only what the Best Available Science said, but the experience of other jurisdictions and whether there were some tools in those toolboxes we could bring here.
Yeah.
So going from 1,000 to 2,500 increases that departure from Best Available Science, but we're trying to narrow that back down by saying only the least quality wetlands are candidates there, and we're going to have a better mitigation regime to make up for that impact.
And how's the Department of Ecology go from 1,000 to 4,000? Where do they get their numbers if they've also left a Best Available Science at the door? Do you know?
What I think they've said is frankly, they recognize that the cities need to balance both the property use interests and the environmental protection interests.
Okay.
The guidance that they've given us is that they think this amendment is within the right area. I'll echo one of Cameron's comments just to make sure that the council is aware. Some of the proponents of this particular amendment, the Geese in particular, probably are interested in this being part of a shoreline master program project. If that's where the council goes, this would be within the shoreline jurisdiction, at least in that particular case.
Mm-hmm.
There may be other isolated wetlands or small value wetlands elsewhere in the city that could take advantage of the code amendment, but I just want to make sure that the council is aware that some of the public that's been commenting very actively throughout the process and has engaged a lot of time in this process would be interested in that shoreline master program amendment.
One more question.
So did this, the Department of Ecology has seen this, right? With the movement of taking part of that wetland and sliding it up here, did it pass the sniff test with those guys, or did they seem to have a problem with it?
They gave us essentially a yellow light pending the cumulative impact analysis that we're in the process of reviewing right now.
Okay.
You may recall we had the contract last week.
So just to make sure that Councilmember Curley has a full answer to the question, the yellow light is in that stoplight framework, so it wasn't a red saying no, we can't approve
okay.
it, but it wasn't yet a green saying this looks all good. So the yellow light says caution, you have some homework to do. That's why we're doing the cumulative impact analysis right now.
Mm-hmm.
That'll be provided to the council in the coming months there. And part of our job as staff is to keep that liaison with Ecology. And the council goes through the process, and then we can continue to report to you any updated information on their perspective.
That's good.
Any questions? So first I'll ask Councilmember James if he has a question, since he hasn't asked yet. Councilmember Vance?
Sounds like from your discussion of this that the yellow light is kind of along the lines of what former council member Mark Cross was suggesting. In Renton, they may, 4,000 may be the number, but there are other mitigating, I use the word mitigation, but other mitigating, let's say, regulations that form a backdrop to that particular issue. So going and looking at any individual city's specific regulation on any particular aspect of this may not be the whole picture, would it?
I think that's consistent with what I certainly heard from Department of Ecology, and I think consistent with their message to us in some of their written documentation.
One more question before we go on. We're looking at these as low value, but we're looking at from both the point of view of habitat as well as watershed factors?
Well, watershed is a component that's not in the current proposed amendment before you. We are looking at it in terms of hydrologic and water quality or water retention, and riparian would be another version of this associated essentially with a bigger context, similar to the wetland mosaic idea.
We
offer one other thought related to Councilmember Curley's questions and honestly your questions now. Yes, it's true we departed from best of all science with this particular amendment, but I would encourage the council not to think of departure as a black or white type thing. While we have departed from best available science in the sense that we aren't allowing fill here, we're including other aspects that would be based on best available science, the habitat score, the context of the isolated wetland, etc.
Well, I guess what I'm saying is that from my, you know, I'm trying to get my mind around the idea of saying yes or no, or at least a head nod, I guess, tonight. In terms of just the stormwater aspects of it, a 44,000 square foot, even a 2,500 square foot wetland they come in all sizes. That can be quite a bit of water as well, and that can absorb quite a bit of water over the course of a rainy season. Just to clarify, we're making sure that water goes someplace good instead of somebody's backyard?
Well, we are requiring the mitigation, and maybe a quick side note, just to get your head around the 2,500 square foot number, that's about the size of this room. It's a little bit bigger than the size of this room would be the size wetland we're talking about. The wetland mitigation would require that we deal with both components, both factors that a wetland of this size would provide, the habitat and the hydrologic water retention component. So I think former council member Cross was noting that, you know, wetlands like this attenuate stormwater flow. They kind of act like a giant sponge. They soak it up and then slowly release it. As part of a fill exercise of a wetland here, we would require that something else on site start taking over that function.
I guess I wouldn't call that low value to begin with, but that's just an opinion, I guess.
Thank you. Council member Whitten.
I have several questions. Why did you limit your low value determination to habitat only? What was the validity for excluding water quality, flooding attenuation, all those other functions of a wetland?
Well, in the context of the isolated wetland, of course, we don't expect there to be a lot of water quality function served by the isolated wetland. For the wetland with the reduced buffer, we're not allowing the fill there. That sponge effect I was alluding to a moment ago is related to the low value in the category where we have a non-isolated wetland. So we're allowing additional buffer impact there, but we're not actually allowing fill.
Okay, let me tell you why I have a concern. I mean, and it's because of these other functions, especially in lake basins. The Pine Lake Park had a isolated wetland by the parking lot where it's now, used to be right next to the tennis courts. They had a 100-year storm, and it flooded, and it took out the drain field of the neighbors immediately next to the park, on at least on a temporary basis. It actually ditched under the foundation of the house next to it, going into the lake, and then it came over on the third property, which was mine. But I mean, it didn't do any damage to mine, but the other neighbors were just, I mean, they couldn't, you can't inhabit a house without a drain field. Right. So, and this was hydrologically identified as an isolated wetland that the county found didn't serve its function with a 100-year storm, but that was because of the additional creation of impervious surface around it. They had paved, it happened the year or the year after, they paved the driveway into the park, and the neighbors whose drain field flooded took down all the trees, and so all the things that would attenuate water coming on were gone. So it was no longer hydrologically not connected. So how can you predict if an isolated wetland today is isolated that when you develop around it, especially if you fill it, you're not going to have water going into our lakes? And I want to point out, water, the function of the wetland for water quality is gone. We do not require water quality treatment for runoff coming from single-family homes. So if you permit development in the lake basin and take out the wetlands that help with water quality and help attenuate the flooding, you know, you're going to create surface water that has to go someplace and find another way to go into the lake, and it won't be treated. Whereas the wetland has a water quality treatment function as well as an attenuation function. So, and 4,000 square feet, what's the value of a 4,000 square foot wetland in terms of the other functions reduced to when you've permitted a fill of 2,500 feet? I mean, it seems to me that you don't have any justification for eliminating these other factors. They're too important to water quality and to hydrological function. I mean, there's what's the offset for the hydrological function, especially as you build up around it? I mean, a detention pond isn't going to, and you don't require detention ponds for single-family homes. So, I mean, you're taking away those functions and filling them, and you're not requiring mitigation for that, from what I can see. So I have a lot of concern with this approach. I'm not saying in all cases you couldn't arrive at this, but you can't ignore those other functions in saying, well, you can do this, you know, and even if you have to mitigate it. I just don't see on us two fragile lakes that you're going to mitigate for phosphorus loading. We don't require any phosphorus treatment for single family. We don't require LID for single family. We don't, you know, we're exempt from that NPDES permit for the 1 acre or less. So I don't see the justification here for this approach. Maybe if it were radically modified to include questions like that and to evaluate a wetland as a low functioning one in terms of these other functions, but to limit it to habitat doesn't make sense.
Thank you. Deputy Manager.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Mayor. There's a lot of things in Councilmember Whitten's questions here, and I won't do justice to all of them, but I'll give it a try. Planning Commission had a lot of testimony on this subject. This is probably one of the three or four most controversial subjects. It wasn't unanimous, but they did vote, I think, either 5-1 or 6-1 for the recommendation. You notice the title of this item is item 3-19E, which means that 319 A, B, C, and D were rejected before we got to 319E. And the reason that the previous versions of this were not sufficient is that they failed either an environmental test or some other aspect of that evaluation form. And so it was not an easy process to go through and come up with the recommendation that they have. As I said, there is an additional impact because of the larger size, but they've tried to balance that with these additional requirements and narrowing of criteria for the types of candidate wetlands that would actually qualify. So getting to Councilmember Whitten's point about how do you determine isolation? There is technical ways that the staff can apply to do that. It isn't something that we rely either just on the applicant's statement or my department's staff, but we involve Public Works, who have hydrologic expertise in evaluating a proposal from an applicant saying, hey, I've got an isolated wetland. Well, before we approve that, we need to really make sure. And so there's everything from topography review to site visits to looking for other examples of hydrologic connections, both surface as well as subsurface. So we put the applicant through the paces before we make that determination. That is one way of narrowing, again, the type of wetland that we're talking about.
But how do you judge that against changing conditions, which include increased impervious surface around the wetland and weather events, which, for example, you know, our weather's changing?
Yeah. Those are tougher to get to on an individual permit basis, especially the change in weather or climate. But in terms of the impact from surrounding properties, that's part of that hydrologic analysis. Where I've seen this, and I don't say that I would have an encyclopedic knowledge of every permit that staff have gone through personally, and I know that surprises Councilmember Curley because I've told him I have this encyclopedic knowledge, but have some water. The few examples that I am familiar with, because they've risen up to my level for review, they're typically larger sites in less dense areas where the applicant's working with pretty well-known site features there. And so the local area is pretty well-known in terms of how the hydrology works. And this isolated wetland can be confirmed through the type of site analysis I'm talking about. If the council needs, we'll ask some of our friends.
What about the water quality issue?
So that's another aspect of the what will eventually need to be the council's judgment. The Planning Commission essentially set up two types of criteria that would say, here's the candidate wetlands to look at, two or three. One is no wetlands larger than 4,000 square feet are a candidate for this, and you can only fill 2,500 of that. So that's one way of looking, it's a size issue. Second is the only isolated wetlands, and you have to have a determined on-site test to confirm that. Third, you have to have a very low habitat score. Now, is that low enough? That's something the council can consider. Looking at the example we heard earlier in public testimony, Renton's score was 20, ours is 15, so it's actually a little bit lower. So the types of wetlands that we're talking about have even less valuable habitat than the type of wetland in Renton. Water quality was not part of this that I can recall, unless Evan can remind me if there was a criterion that was looked at in terms of which wetlands would qualify there.
No, water quality is not a component. We do have, again, the mitigation requirement, which has been expanded beyond what was likely applicable in the Pine Lake circumstance. And I'll remind the City Council, one of actually the minor items also deals with water quality and how we handle in the lake management area, which would be a change that we'll get to in a week or two. But I would echo many of Cameron's comments, and I'll be quiet.
Okay. And thank you, Deputy City Manager, for reminding us both the recommendation of the Planning Commission and the staff on this. Councilmember James.
I was trying to think on Citizen Lipinski's comments earlier as we're gathering information before we start deliberating. What was it, more stringent, do nothing, less stringent? What was the fourth item?
He had four or just three?
He had three, but then three. He had
an
ad hoc
comment.
Yeah, I can't remember if he had a fourth item. My question to the Planning Commission chair and vice chair was, Renton was given as an example of 4,000 square feet, fill it all. But there was a jurisdiction that we considered a peer city that was using 2,500 feet. It was either Redmond, Bellevue, Issaquah. Do you recall which of those cities that was a peer city that allowed for fill of 25?
Well, actually, most of the cities we normally consider peer cities in this type of exercise, so the ones immediately surrounding us, Issaquah, Redmond, Bellevue, Kirkland, Mercer Island, use a threshold that's more consistent with the 2,500 square feet that you have in the draft Planning Commission code before you tonight. The 4,000 square feet, you would have to cast a broader net. and look at, you know, elsewhere in King County.
So this isn't necessarily off the charts compared to our peer city review that we often do.
I think that's where the 2,500 square foot number came from, frankly, as we looked at some of our peer jurisdictions for the amount of alteration.
I just wanted clarification on that topic.
Another question, Councilmember James?
No, that would be it.
Okay. Well, following on that question, I have a series of questions, and I'll be follow on Councilmember James' question. I understand that King County has been referenced as also having 4,000, and as you had mentioned previously to my earlier request, you'll be providing us information on both Renton and King County that had been mentioned before. How exactly did we get 2,500? And I know that you're saying it's in the ballpark. How did we arrive at that number?
Well, the 2,500 square foot, as Cameron said, it came out of several iterations of this conversation. We initially proposed, proposed to the Planning Commission an isolated wetland area of 2,500 square feet as being on par with the jurisdictions I just referenced, Issaquah, Redmond, Kirkland.
But none of them have 2,500, is that correct?
All actually are in that 2,500 range. Some are in the 2,000, some are lower, some are down in 200, some are up around 2,700, I believe.
And that's why I guess I saw this scatter shot, and I'm trying to figure out where we got our number.
Well, and so 2,500 fit within the range of our immediate peer jurisdictions. We had a lot of public testimony, and you heard some of it, frankly, tonight, that the 4,000 square foot threshold was the more appropriate threshold. When we consulted with the Department of Ecology and said, hey, look, you know, if we look at the City of Renton's code, which has this 4,000 square foot isolated wetland exemption that you actually saw in the GE presentation tonight, adopted into their Shoreline Master Program, the Department of Ecology guidance was pretty firm that, again, we don't want to look at just the specific flexibility tool that we're discussing at the moment, the 4,000 square foot exemption, but take a look at the entire critical areas code. With that, we started talking about the 2,500 square foot alteration of a 4,000 square foot isolated wetland, which led us to where we are today.
Okay. Also, Councilmember Witten had mentioned before about best available science and water quality. There had been a previous testimony that said that for 10,000 or even 4,000 and lower, that there are no studies that show isolated wetlands affecting water quality. Is that correct?
No, that's not quite correct. And this is one of the areas where probably the staff's characterization of the best available science differs from some of the public comment you've received. What we don't have is a study that identifies a lower end for where water quality benefits are realized or habitat benefits are realized from isolated wetlands. The studies only go down into that 10,000, 4,000 square foot threshold you referenced a moment ago. But actually, Department of Ecology has been very clear in their public comment that there is no study that shows there is not a water quality value or habitat value below that number. That's my understanding of the best available science.
So there is no study under 10,000, but that there is some value, and as you had mentioned earlier, up to a square foot, but they also said that's not practical. Is that correct?
Right.
The characterization of it?
I think that's the way they've been characterizing it, and frankly, the staff and I believe the citizens have as well. This is a flexibility tool.
All right. The third question I have, I had listened to a number and attended a number of the planning commissions, and I saw Planning Commissioner Mabubu frequently on a number of occasions ask how many of these isolated, low-value, low-functioned wetlands do we have in our city, and I understand that this is the only one identified so far. How many have you identified in the last 7 years since the last review?
You know, frankly, it's never come up on the development review scheme. We don't regulate 4,000 square foot isolated wetlands now. So if it came up as part of a subdivision application or a building permit application, the fact that it was 4,000 square feet and isolated would not be an item of note in the development review. What we focused on up until now is the 1,000 square foot or less. And I think we testified to the Planning Commission that we knew of maybe 5 or 6 thousand square foot or less isolated wetlands. The short answer to your question, Deputy Mayor, is we don't know how many isolated wetlands of 4,000 square feet or less there are in the city. That would be an item that we hope to get a better sense of as part of our cumulative impact analysis.
But as of right now, what you have identified is, you mentioned the Planning Commissioner Mabubu's one, is that correct?
As far as we know right now, there's one. There may be a lot more. There may be no more.
Understand. And one last one here before. Mark Cross had mentioned before the need to take into a holistic view as we start to look at these differences, and I fully agree, and I'd like to be able to see, and I mentioned to you before the council meeting, a framework that was used to understand what does holistic mean and how do they evaluate it, because otherwise, if we don't understand that holistic view, then there is no other choice but to look at each one individually to go forward. And so if there is a framework, I think the council would be very much interested in seeing that framework. Any other questions?
Mm-hmm.
Councilmember Whitten.
Yes. Would you also look at the types of lakes that the larger exemption would be permitted within their basins? For example, Renton, I think they're protecting Lake Washington, which is very different from phosphorus loading into a 80-some acre lake like Pine or Beaver. So when you look at comparability and differences, would you please take a look at what water resources might be at issue where water quality is or is of not significant concern? And if you're hydrologically, it has a water quality function of, if it's isolated, not permitting the water to go to the lake, correct? So if it's polluted with a nutrient like phosphorus, if it, the wetland's there, it stays in the wetland, presumptively, correct?
Yeah, if it's isolated, it should.
So only in large events or something would it overflow into the lake, but if you take away and fill that wetland, what's to keep that stormwater that otherwise would have gone there from going into the lake?
That would be a component of the mitigation required under this proposed amendment.
But we don't require treatment of single-family homes for phosphorus.
I think what Councilmember Whitten's asking for is, could we take into account the water quality functions of the wetland that's proposed to be impacted in terms of the decision making?
What I would like staff to look at is defining low impact wetlands in terms of all their functions, especially in our lake basins where water quality is a huge issue.
Okay.
But also hydrological, because you're sending the water somewhere else.
Okay, we'll take a look at that.
Thank you. Any other questions from the council? Seeing no other questions from the council, and having this proposal in front of us, pending the information that will be provided on Renton and on King County that we can talk about at the time of deliberation, following our normal process, I'd like to see if we have a consensus in supporting what the Planning Commission's and staff's recommendation for 319E, if we could have a head nod or a shake accordingly. All in favor, nod. All against, shake. We have three nods to two palms. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor.
Are we prepared, since we're ahead of schedule, to go to the next item?
Sure.
Thank you.
Just a couple things. We'll jump to the next item in 1 second. Do have a couple of known questions already I wanted to make sure the Planning Commission was aware of. We had two questions that came up in our small group discussions. Questions on the agency comments and then a list of species of concern. City Council may recall that we sent out an email on Friday which addressed both of these questions. We had the request for the roadmap from Councilmember Whitten, which we've started. You've seen a draft of tonight.
Thank you.
We also have the comparison table that Deputy Mayor Valderrama's brought up, and we will be providing that to you. I would like just to call to the attention of the City Council, another question that came up, I believe from Mayor O'Dell, was what other substantive minor items might be out there in terms of significant changes to the environmental critical area regulations that are not currently under the council's review as part of this major item scope. There's four that immediately come to mind. I'll just go over these briefly, and we'll probably add to this list in preparation of our April 15th meeting.
I'm going to ask Evan to pause just for a moment, just so that we make sure we know what we're doing here. I think it was Councilmember Vance that actually asked for this list of what are the substantive items off of the quote-unquote minor items list. In your volume one, you have a tab under tab one called major and minor items. The memo has a list of the major items, and then there's a summary list of the minor items that goes over two pages. Those minor items don't have an evaluation form. They didn't rise to the level for that level of analysis. Most of these are fairly straightforward, and they mostly fall into two categories. Housekeeping and clarification changes, and then substantive changes that actually do change the code in some way. Much of them came from the best available science reports. So again, there's a basis in a study or some kind of documentation that you have. You've asked the staff to identify of these substantive items which ones should we kind of highlight at the city council process. So that's what Evan's attempted to do here, is to identify at least four of those. We're going to keep looking through this list, and if there are additional ones we want to bring up to the council's attention in a future meeting, we will do that. But we had room tonight, we thought, to fit in these four. I would like to ask Evan to go through these one at a time and then pause in between so that the deputy mayor can ask for questions.
Thank you. Please continue, Evan.
Thank you. So the First Amendment really is related to lake management areas, and this is an item I noted to Councilmember Witten just a moment ago. We currently regulate phosphorus generation around Pine and Beaver Lake. Pine and Beaver Lake are both very sensitive to phosphorus pollutants entering the lake and causing, frankly, lake water quality problems. Currently, the lakes are regulated for new development generating more than 5,000 square feet of pollution generating impervious surface. This would be a driveway or a road, something that generates pollution as runoff. The proposed change here that came from our consultant was to start to look at things like redevelopment, where we might generate large amounts of pollution generating non-impervious surfaces or pollution generating pervious surfaces. So this would be in the category of a 7,000 square foot lawn, for example, where you might have a heavy use of fertilizers, maybe not phosphorus fertilizers, and then yard waste or clippings running off into the lake itself. This would be another phosphorus control mechanism that we've added into the lake management area requirements. Any questions before I move on to the next one?
Evan, off the minor items list, this is item 3-12, it looks to me.
This is 3-12.
Mm-hmm. So if you have a 50, 60-foot wide lot, I think is the minimum for a new lot for the lake, or you're redeveloping on a 50 or whatever, and it's an average, let's say, 3,000-something square foot home, and it's a half-acre lot. So even though they may not have 7,000 square feet of lawn, they wouldn't be, if it were under that hypothetical you mentioned, would they be required to do any phosphorus treatment or?
No, we did set the threshold at a certain amount of new pervious pollution generating surface. I believe the number was 7,000 square feet. It could be a number that would be set lower. This was really when we were talking about this with the Planning Commission, I think we were looking at redevelopment of the existing lots really around Beaver and Pine, which tend to be larger lots in general. In thinking of things that, another example of this might be the sport court that has leaf material. Well, sport court's a bad example, actually. That's impervious. It's probably the lawn or the massive landscape area that's really the most prevalent example here.
So there would be cumulatively potentially a lot of lots that might not be impacted with this requirement.
Right. But we are trending from just focusing on new towards redevelopment as well.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Now let's proceed.
Okay. Second item is a little bit deceptively significant in the sense that we're talking about landslide hazard area buffers. And most people are probably more familiar with the term steep slopes. Mm-hmm. Steep slopes in Sammamish mean a slope that's over 40%, at least 10 feet tall. That means you have an elevation change of 10 feet within a distance of 25 feet. That's the type of slope we're talking about. What our current code does is it requires that you have a buffer off the top, the toe of that steep slope, and then actually off the sides. So if you move laterally along the hillside, and a portion of that hillside's over 40%, but the remainder of that hillside might be less, it might be 30% or 25%, we have a buffer off the side of that slope moving laterally. This is one I'm gonna probably create a graphic for you on April 15th. But what we're doing here is we're eliminating that side buffer off the top or off the side of the steep slope, because it actually doesn't provide any additional safety factor to the slope stability. This is a fairly large constraint, I'll tell you, in the Inglewood and Tamarack neighborhoods where we have isolated areas that are over 40% and you have buffers extending off to the side across slope. So we're getting rid of that as well.
Any questions from the council? Oh, first, Deputy City Manager has a comment.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Mayor. Thinking about Joe Lipinski's testimony of having a regulation that is tailored and narrowed to the aspect that's really necessary, this would fit in that narrowed category from my perspective, because the buffer off to the side does not actually relate to the hazard involved, so it's kind of an additional restraint on the property owner that's not providing a protection either to them or to a downhill site, like the top and toe setbacks would. So I think this is a helpful clarification that, especially in the areas that Evan mentioned, will help those property owners.
Thank you. Council Member Witten?
I don't understand what you mean by side buffer. Is it if you're a slope, if you have a straight line,
right,
that's the top of the hill, is the side buffer parallel to that, or is it on the side of the property?
And I apologize, we didn't have a chance to create a graphic for this that would
But what help, are you talking about? Can you explain that?
So, yeah, we'll give it a chance. Why don't you give it one more shot, Evan, and then I'll jump in if...
Yeah, well, I also had a question about erosion. You know, it seems to me that the slopes next to a steep slope can affect erosion in the steep slope. So I'm trying to figure out what this looks like.
So let me attempt to address both questions one more time. And I'll note for the record, of course, this came from our consultant as part of their Best Available Science evaluation. This is item 4-7 in your packet. If you're standing at the top of that steep slope and you're looking down over the hillside.
Well, give me a line.
Well, bear with me. If you're standing on the line that is the top of the steep slope, say on the Ebright Creek Ravine, and you're looking down, some of that Ebright Creek Ravine has slopes that exceed 40%,
okay,
and then off to your left, there might be some slopes that are not over 40%. If you walk down that line along the top of the hill till you get to a point where you're above the 35% slope, and you walk down the hill, if you're standing kind of mid-hill and you look back to your right, you would see the 40% slope and there would be a buffer coming over to where you're standing. That's what I mean when I say the side buffer's off that slope. You're not actually in a critical area, and where you are doesn't have an effect on the stability of the slope that's off to your right, mm-hmm, but there is a buffer there that we're providing protection around.
Thank you.
Related to Councilmember Vance's question, erosion hazard areas in this city are largely characterized by two things. Very shortly, one is soil type. Almost all of this city is erosive if you are above a 15% gradient. 15%, just to remind people, is a foot and a half of elevation rise in 10 feet of distance. So the erosion hazard areas would be across slopes below 40% on down to 15%, and we have erosion control measures required for any development in that area, regardless of the landslide hazard steep slope protection requirements. So we have requirements for erosion sediment control during construction. We have actually in the proposed regulations from the Planning Commission, water quality monitoring requirements, site stability requirements, the like, to deal with erosion directly.
All right, let's proceed.
Thank you. The third item here is actually related to how we evaluate slope stability and slope safety when we're allowing for an alteration to a steep slope or a reduction in the buffer. Currently, what our code says is that in some cases, when we're allowing for an alteration of landslide hazard areas, steep slopes, or frankly, non-steep slopes that are also geologically hazardous, we base that allowance to alter those slopes on the recommendation of a geotechnical engineer. And what the geotechnical engineer almost literally says is the proposed project will not destabilize the hillside or create a landslide hazard area or a landslide hazard. What we don't have in our code right now is factors of safety that the geotechnical engineer has to evaluate when making that statement. So what our consultant recommended to the city is that we include a factor of safety as part of that geotechnical analysis, rather than simply recommending or relying on the recommendation of a geotechnical engineer with no parity from engineer to engineer on how they evaluate factors of safety. So we've added that in.
Mm-hmm. Question from the council? I have a question. Where are these factors of safety coming from? Is there a state?
It actually does come out of the state guidance. It came from the Washington Department of Transportation guidance on how they put together side slopes for new highway construction.
All right, thank you.
Recollection.
If there's no other question, let's proceed.
The last one, I've rolled several items into this one bullet. Essentially what we received recommendations from the consultant related to both streams and wetlands, and related to both buffer increases and buffer reductions. A requirement that we provide functional criteria when we're talking about a buffer increase or a buffer decrease. What this means is, you know, of course, buffers are provided around wetlands and streams to provide protection for specific functions and values of that feature. In the case of streams, it might be a habitat function or value. It may also be a water quality function or value. There may be other aspects to that. So those each break down further. For habitat, you might have woody debris, types, variety of plants, things of that nature. For water quality, you might look at gradient and other types of site conditions. What we've done is we've put those functional criteria into the code for specific evaluation when we are looking at, frankly, adjusting the wetland or stream buffer down or up. There was a fair bit of attention paid to this item as part of the Planning Commission's review related to the situation where we might increase a buffer. I think they were more comfortable with this when they heard that the city has only ever increased the wetland buffer once. And that was related to the Mystic Lake bog, and we were going from 200 to 215 feet.
Any questions from the council? Now, Evan, remind me, as I look back over the original handoff memo, there was no vote taken on this. Where was the Planning Commission as far as these minor recommendations?
I believe all of the minor items were actually recommended by a consensus of the Planning Commission. All of these are based on best available science and were not items that received substantive public comment.
Are there any questions or objections, any of these from the council members? If not, in seeking and following the same process we've taken before, let's see if we can get a consensus on this. And if I can get a head nod to support this. Oh, hold on a second, Councilmember Whitten.
I'd rather, on the first item, take a look and see how it fits in with the lake management plans that we have, and if there are other things like the recommendation on open space that should be incorporated. I mean, I think it's great to do something, but I think at some point in time, maybe this isn't the process. We should be looking at more of the things that were recommended.
Evan?
And thank you, Councilmember Whitten. That reminds me, actually, we have a Beaver Lake Management District board meeting this Thursday, and the board has asked to provide a recommendation or document memo to the City Council related to these items. They actually, I believe, support the lake management area modifications. They've had a chance to review it as part of the
plan. I support it, but I wonder if there aren't some additional things that we should be looking at, or whether we should be making that a smaller area. Some kind of science data on it might be helpful too.
Can the city come back to us later on at the time of deliberation and provide us additional input?
Or at one of the pre-extra meetings. I think it's a great recommendation. I'm not sure if there aren't other things that might be low-hanging fruit that we would be wise to look at also.
All right. With that, let's go to the head nods. All in favor, please nod. Anybody opposed? Then by five head nods.
And so that is the end of the items I had prepared for tonight. I do have two other items that we were scheduled to talk about next week queued up, if the council would like to continue on or not.
I'm not personally not ready to go into some.
Well, I don't believe it's going to be for discussion. It's only to present it to us, and then we come back for questions. And that, if I understand correctly, is that correct, Devin?
Well, I don't. We're missing two people who.
Understand, but I have spoken to them, and we're not going to go into the discussion. It would just only be the presentation.
I still would
and
rather have it. I haven't looked at the materials. I'm going by the proposed presentation, and I want to be prepared with science and the recommendation forms and so forth. So that's me. I mean, I didn't know it was possible.
I agree. I think, you know, have a chance to look at it, the background, and read the basic science and everything else.
What are you hoping to accomplish by having?
No, just to get that presentation given to us and we follow by questions.
But it's,
I know, but the other guys are going to want the same thing, and they're not going to.
Yeah. Given that, then we will postpone that till next week. Yes, Councilmember Vance.
Could we have a chance for a couple of, we've had some things come up over the last couple of weeks that still relate to things we've discussed or have been in the public comment. Will we have a chance for some general questions tonight? Or
we can take them right now, some general questions. Yes,
sure. Well, can I start?
Yes, Councilmember
Vance. This is something that I've, this is really for my own edification. We've heard a couple things about the status of Lake Sammamish, particularly related to phosphorus, and I guess my understanding of what was said here tonight and has been said I think a couple of other times was that the reasoning behind the suggestion that the lake, at least in the regard to phosphorus as opposed to some of the other issues, is apparently not so bad is because the phosphorus is going in, but it's layering itself in, but it's a colder and deeper areas of the lake. And part of the reason for that is that we have a lowering of flows into the lake. I think tonight the gentleman mentioned Issaquah Creek, and I'm sure that's probably true of other creeks as well. I guess my question is, if we're now looking at tightlining stormwater down to the lake from lots of different directions, are we now going to suddenly have a problem that we didn't have before?
Well,
so I don't think we're going to try to take on an answer to that.
I didn't
question.
Expect an answer tonight, but I would like to have
tonight,
an answer.
But we can take that and come back to you with
thank you,
an answer.
Councilmember Whitten, do you have a question?
Treated or just dumped into the pipe?
No.
It's untreated.
You don't need to hear me.
All right. With no further ado, I will close the study session. We will now have, if there's council reports to be done. Starting from our right, Councilmember Vance, please.
Tonight at 5:30 in the room next door, we had the first, I would call it an informational and organizing meeting of the Community and Economic Development Committee. That I think went pretty well. We had a good introduction to the new consultant, CAI. We had some input from staff and the council that was there. It included John James and Nancy Whitten, and actually had Romero Valderrama for a while. So I think that went well. I think we're now trying to put together a schedule for future meetings, and it looks like over the next 3 or 4 months we'll be doing community and economic development pretty much on a monthly basis. So keep your eye open if you're interested in that issue. We'll be announcing all of these meetings, of course, our public meetings, and you're all welcome.
Thank you. Councilmember Crowley?
Nothing to report.
Councilmember Whitten?
Nothing.
Councilmember James?
Last week, Don Jaron and I were at the Eastside Transportation Partnership meeting in Bellevue, and we had a legislative update. It's looking a little dicey as to whether any type of a revenue package will make it through Olympia this year with the school issues and other fundings being debated. But the county spoke up, and our representative, Kathy Lambert's concern is that without additional revenues, our county roads, and often their connector roads between the various urban areas, may go to gravel. So that was alarming, and not that I'm for car tabs, but something's got to be done to fix the funding mechanism
for the county, and it will affect us on our local basis because they are shared revenues. The consensus of Eastside Transportation Partnership was is to wait and see which of the bills may surface to the top, re-examine them, and maybe lend some support to one of the bills. So stay tuned.
Thank you. I have three things to report. First of all, I attended with Councilmember Don Gerund the Suburban Cities meeting where they talked about the tolling on 520 and a request by neighboring or adjacent cities that want to seek some of the money from the 520 tolling for mitigations as to what's happening with the traffic that's been diverted to their neighborhoods going forward, and to try to see if cities going forward in the future can look at this as a mechanism, whether it's I-90 or other roads, to help those that are in need of some mitigation.
You know, even Sammamish has been impacted, so if they go forward with that, would you please make a note for staff to stay on top of that and maybe present some information that would show what impact that's having on us and how we should be also compensated.
Well said. Again, there is also concern, and we've already had reports on the solid waste transfer station, and that continues to go forward. There was also an emergency movement on House Bill 1253 and State Bill 5262, looking for flexibility on the use of local lodging taxes, that they were trying to make it more restrictive, and they'd like to make sure that we keep more flexibility for our cities. Finally, I'd like to also make mention that tomorrow at 5:15, East Lake High School, the Parks Department will be inaugurating their new multi-purpose ball field / soccer / lacrosse field.
/ football.
/ football, I would hope. Yes, Councilmember Vance.
Will you be cutting, do we get somebody to cut the ribbon there for that?
I will be cutting
will be
the
there.
Ribbon.
Good, because I'll be in Seattle, so I was too bad to miss that, because I would like to have been there.
Yeah. Yeah, fast pitch curly, it was not going to be available, so.
Yeah, I have no high heat.
All right. With that, then.
Ice up.
Oh, yeah, ice it down. Yeah. All right, with that, then we adjourn the study session. Thank you very much.